This is the story. I just got back yesterday from the Grand Canyon. This is the story of how I almost died in the Grand Canyon. Not for real, but like not for real. Like that's definitely clickbait, but it's not a lot of clickbait. So for those of you who don't know, I just got back from the Grand Canyon. I went there to do a very specific long run slash hike. For those of you who don't know the Grand Canyon, I'll just pull up this image real quick. There is the Grand Canyon in Arizona. Huge. It's like 270, 280 miles long. On average, from the south rim, where most people access it, to the north rim, there is a linear distance of like 10 miles. However, the canyon, if you've never been there, I cried the first time I went there. I cried this time I went. This is like my fourth or fifth time there. The Grand Canyon is this amazing, mind-blowing place. If you have not been, you absolutely need to go. I went with some friends with the goal of running rim to rim to rim. What that means is starting on the south rim, running down all the way. You say, that's not a very long distance. It's not. To the Colorado River, which has carved out the Grand Canyon over time. Then running all the way to the north rim, and then running back. So rim to rim to rim. It's about 44 miles, and it is about 11,000 feet of climbing and descending. So you go up 2 straight vertical miles over the course of those 44 miles, and you go down 2 straight vertical miles over the course of all those miles. This is what it looks like. You're basically never running on a flat section. This is the elevation profile. Start at 7,000 feet. Over 6 miles, you drop insanely far. You spend the next 15 miles climbing up slowly, and then not so slowly, and then so not slowly. And here's why I did this. A long time ago, I first went to the Grand Canyon. It blew my mind. I was just getting into trail running. I was just getting into like ultra running. And this is one of the most iconic trail runs in the world. It is very remote. It is insanely beautiful. I have a million pictures to show you here in just a second. And it is also really difficult because of the up and down. However, I scratched this itch before once, actually. You're about to see, you know, visual warning. You're about to see some photos of Ryan as a 22-year-old with no glasses, weird hair. So just prepare yourself for that. In 2015, I went on a hike into the Grand Canyon. Actually, let's go back a photo real quick. I did this with my stepdad, Dean. I went down South Kaibab, which is about 6 miles. I stayed overnight here at Phantom Ranch, which is a campground and a place you can stay. And then I hiked out Bright Angel. So in 2 days, I did about 20 miles with my stepdad, Dean, who has since passed. But at the time, it was his goal to be able to do this big hike, and we did it together. And it was one of my, it's one of the most special memories to me ever. This was about 3 years before he passed from cancer. He'd already had cancer at this point one time. We set out to do this, and we did it. And it was, it's one of my favorite memories. And the minute, in the fall, when Megan and I realized that we were going to have a baby, I had this weird itch. This is my stepdad, Dean. This is us hiking down South Kaibab the first day. Ignore the bandana. Ignore the hair. When I knew I was going to be a dad, I thought, first off, I'm about to have so much less time available to myself. And second off, one of the most special memories I have with Dean, and like a thing I wanted to like do, I don't know. I don't know how to explain it. There's just an emotional connection there to this place and my stand-in dad, Dean, and the fact that I'm about to be a dad. We had a really long, hard day, a couple days. The Grand Canyon is incredible. We had a great time. But this was going to be a step up. This was going to be a big step up. We were going to do it all in one day, and we were going to go twice as far and do twice as much climbing and descending. And so I got some friends together. And they said yes. And so we set off to do rim to rim to rim at the Grand Canyon. And it went really well at first. First off, we started at like 3:30 in the morning. We got to the trailhead with headlamps on. We descended those first six downhill miles in the dark. The stars were incredible. The moon was incredible. None of these photos are going to do it any justice, but we were just headlights bobbing along in the dark, seeing these black, massive walls of the canyon all of a sudden just like shoot up around us while the stars were... The Grand Canyon is, and the area is really, is a dark park in terms of, like, they don't want you to use lights minus headlamps. So it was beautiful. It was really, really beautiful. I laughed out loud. It went really well at first. Just you fucking wait, Caitlin. Just you fucking wait. So first couple hours, we're just descending in the dark. It was great. I don't know how loud this video is going to be. Just running in the dark with headlamps on, chatting, having a good time. I don't know if you'll be able to see any of this, really. I haven't even watched this video. Just stepping down these big steps for like six straight miles. It's actually kind of hard on your legs to run that hard downhill because you're just constantly bouncing and hitting. Made it to the bottom. This is a terrible photo that I think I took. right as the sun starts to come up, and then we started to have a whole day. Did you wear running shoes or hiking boots? Running shoes, and we ran a lot of it, minus the hard, hard uphills, and we took a lot of breaks. But we carried all our water, we carried all our food. We get down to the river, and then you start the slow climb up. And as we did that, the sun started to rise. It started to paint the canyon walls multiple colors, and we started to go up and up and up. This is us. This is the sheer cliff fucking wall ahead of us. Oh my God. We went up so far. The north rim of the... I've been to the canyon, I think, four or five times at this point. This trip, I think, was maybe my fifth. I've been with Megan. I've been with my family a couple times. I've been really lucky to get to the Grand Canyon. It is my favorite place on Earth. I had never been north of Phantom Ranch, which is like only the small part, the small southern part. The north rim is incredible. It may be prettier than the south rim. And I love this. The south rim is my favorite place on Earth, and it might be prettier than that. It's so remote. The north rim of the canyon is only accessible by a 5-hour drive where you have to go all the way around the canyon to the north rim. Except it's not accessible right now because it's still kind of winter. The north rim still has snow on it. The road to get there is not open. The minute we dropped down the south rim, we were on our own. There was no place to get rescued. There was no place, to get like pulled out of the canyon. The 22 miles that it took to get to the north rim, by the time we got there, we were out in the middle of it. Really, really, really in the backcountry. So anyways, we climbed up and up and up and up. We made it to the north rim. This is me gasping for fucking breath at like 8,000 feet elevation after having climbed for hours. We made great time. This is my friend, Confused Jesus, because he has really, really long hair and he always looks a little confused. We made it to the north rim. There was still snow on the ground, but we ate our food. It was like 10 in the morning. We were making incredible time. It was like we took like less than 7 hours to get there. We were planning on around a 14-hour day, so that made a lot of sense, 14, 15-hour day. Started at 3 in the morning, got there before, like, at around 10 in the morning, ate some food. We were really freaking tired. We were exhausted, and we were halfway there. So then we turned around, and we did the long, long, slow downhill. At this point, everything's going great. I'm there with three other people, four total. Everything's going well. We're all feeling pretty good. We're taking turns, like, oh, my leg hurts, or, like, I'm breathing hard, or like, I'm going to take this next section a little slow. Things are going well. Oh my God. Then it started to get hot. This is my friend Confused Jesus. Because it was April, there is a lot of snow melt leading to waterfalls in the middle of, or like right alongside the trail. I don't remember what the audio says here, so we'll see.
It's the first time he showered in 10 days. Jared Burris, your boy.
That's my friend who I love very much, but does look a little bit homeless. And he took a shower.
Waterfall in the Grand Canyon.
I love him a lot. He does look a little bit homeless. I accidentally said his whole real name there. Whoops. Anyways, it started to get really hot, but we got some water from like waterfalls and dunked our head in. I put my head in. There's like random springs in the middle of the trail. This is just like a
someone poisoned the water hole.
There's just like a random spring in the middle of the trail, which I definitely dunked my head in. That's my butt. Don't look at my butt. It started to get really warm. I was feeling all right at this point, but something started to feel a little wrong. And that's where this story gets weird. We'll get to that here in a second. Don't look at my butt. We'll switch to a different image for now. It started to get really warm, and my stomach started to feel a little weird. And is this another poop your pants story? No, but you're not wrong. Probably at mile, so it's a 44 total mile thing. Probably at mile 32 or 3, I started to feel a little just like my stomach wasn't quite right. And it was getting really warm. And I'm like, you eat the whole time, right? Like you're eating, I eat gels, I eat like gummy bears, I eat like cashews, random like food to give you energy the entire time. So you're constantly eating. So you really need your stomach to be good, especially for like a 14-hour day, because you got to keep taking in calories and keep taking in water so that you can keep having energy to do stuff. Here's the problem. My body said, no, you are not allowed to keep taking in energy and water. And you're not going to have any energy for the rest of the trip. I sort of randomly just puked. I took a gel. Like 20 minutes later, I was just like, bleh. Puked up the gel on the side of the trail. Like, oh man, that wasn't good. That wasn't fun, but I was honestly feeling mostly okay. I just puked. I took a little break. I drank some water. I took a Zofran for the nausea. And we just kept moving. And I was like, it's probably all right. It's probably all right. We got down to the, this was in like this area. We get down to Phantom Ranch where there is actually a canteen and they will sell you sweet ice cold lemonade. I drank an ice cold lemonade. I ate some sea salt and vinegar chips, kettle chips, which were delicious. We took a second to like really break there. Man, I cannot handle vomiting. Gio, you might want to step out for the next 5 minutes of this stream. I got some food in me. We all ate food. We all rested for a while. We needed some like really good solid food that far into the trip. And then we started on the final climb out. So we're like right here. We have this big long ass climb to get out. And this is what the next 7 hours looked like for me. A lot of sitting on the side of the trail, because immediately when I started climbing again, I started vomiting and I couldn't keep anything in, not the lemonade, not the sea salt and, vinegar chips, which I will never have again. I couldn't even keep water down very shortly after I started climbing. Sorry to anybody who's eating. But basically, like long story short, for 7 hours, I had no food, no water. Nothing could go in my body and stay in. I was vomiting. After I got done getting rid of all of that, I started dry heaving. I was just on the side of the trail. My body was attempting to expel stuff that it no longer had access to. And I had a long ass 6 mile straight up hike to do. Why did you continue? Oh, and if I could have not continued, I would have. I, at that point, was at, not at that exact point, but like with like 5 hours left to go, I was wishing for death. Not really, but like, and this is where it comes into the fact that like the Grand Canyon is a very real and really dangerous place. You can get rescued out of the Grand Canyon, but only if the stars align and only if you are in severe, severe danger. It was a really windy day when we were down in the canyon. I don't know if they could have actually flown a helicopter in to get us. The other thing is that if you talk to them on the phone, as I did, 9 years ago with Dean, when Dean was having a really hard time on the trail, they basically won't offer. They will have you stay the night in the canyon on the side of the trail. They'll have you try again in the morning. They'll have you get resources from within the canyon. They won't get you out, basically, unless they absolutely have to. And trust me, I was like, what's the worst case scenario? Can they get me out of here? Long story short, I spent 7 hours. We made the slowest time of all time. We were going to get out at, like, the plan was to finish in 14 hours. We finished in the dark after 18 hours. It had gotten very cold again. It had been windy. We'd been hiking in the dark for like 2 hours. Shout out to my friends who carried my pack and like basically almost pushed me uphill. At one point, they were debating, can you put your arms over our shoulders and we can just carry you out? And I didn't want to do that, but I would have if I would have had to. For 7 hours, for 7 hours, I had no food. And for about six of those hours, it was this constant battle between terrible nausea, the desire to throw up / the need to throw up, having nothing in my body, and having to hike uphill to finish the day. It was one of the hardest things I've ever done. It was also one of the most, like, minus that 7 hours, it was one of the best days of my life. It was really, really cool. And we did finish. And when we finished, I said nothing. I got in the car. I laid my head back. And I asked them to take me to the gas station so that I could get a Sprite. Because I had not had any liquid or food in, like, 7 hours. And I really, really wanted a Sprite. We now love your friends, too. Meg says they told me they had calculated that they were tall enough to make it work. They could have made it work. Shout out to all my friends. Sid carried my pack. Jared carried my water bottles. Lindsay let me borrow her hiking poles because I don't use hiking poles, but then at that point, I really needed them. Lindsay also ran ahead on the trail to call my 32-week pregnant wife and say, hey, Meg. This is Meg's sister, by the way. Hey, Meg, it's Lindsay. Ryan's going to be okay, but we're going to be in the canyon a lot longer than we thought we were. You know how he said probably 14 or 15 hours? We're going to be here for a little bit, but it's all going to be fine. We'll get out of there. Shout out to my friends. I literally could not have done it without them, but the pain behind those eyes, this is the most forced smile I've ever done. That's the story of how I didn't actually almost die in the canyon, but maybe a little bit almost. I was in the literal best hands. Two of them are doctors, emergency medicine doctors. One of them works in a trauma care center in the mountains. I was in the literal best hands, but holy shit. Holy shit. I have a couple extra pictures we can show you as well, but it was overall a really, really special, really incredible time. I'm so happy I did it. I thought of Dean so much that day. The funny thing is, to come full circle, I've told many of you guys this story. 9 years ago when Dean and I did it, I was my friends. I was the people helping. I was the person carrying Dean's pack, making sure he got nutrition, trying to encourage him through his nausea. He had the same day I had 9 years ago. And so I did come, it did come full circle, which was crazy. And just such a unique, weird thing to have happen in reverse. But yeah, that's the story of how, of the Grand Canyon and my Grand Canyon trip. Yeah. I'm glad you made it out okay and still had good memories. I had great memories. I've been so sore for a couple days now, but, sorry, I'm gonna play some music again. Yeah, it's been really good. You're going to stay inside now, right? I'm never going outside again. Glad you made it out okay. Me too. Was it the exertion that caused the nausea or was there another reason? Aaliyah, that's a fantastic question. Probably a mixture of... So basically, if you're going to continue eating while running, you have to have enough blood flow to your stomach for your stomach to be able to process, to function, to be able to process what you're eating. I think I just exerted a little bit too hard, and then once my stomach like went south, I think it just went south. Yeah. I think it was just like I redlined my stomach a little bit, and then and then it went downhill from there. I don't know though. Yeah. My mom asked if you were going to start, if you were going to reconsider mountain running, and I laughed at her. No, it was an awesome day. So Rocky Noah is lurking. I love it. No more Fresh Air Fridays confirmed. Ann says this doesn't compare at all, but it reminds me of, sorry, let me turn this music down. When I was hiking in Iceland and fell through the ice, I had to hike back in negative 12 degrees Celsius while my entire legs were soaking wet and hard from frozen water. I thought I was going to do permanent damage to my legs. Oh my Lord. Why do we do this kind of stuff? That's wild. You were also that person for me in Zion when I puked, Megan says. That's true. Megan had a bad stomach issue in Zion. Yeah. The good news is you left your mark all over the Grand Canyon. It's kind of beautiful in a little indigestion way. You know what, Cabo? I really did. I really left myself out there, you know? I left a lot of the lining of my stomach out there on the side of the trail. Shout out to my stomach.